At this level, it becomes inevitable for us not to analyze, not to offer a micro-level analysis of Indian capitalism, not to offer a detailed critique of everyday forms of organization of capitalism, but we will have to move away from Indian economy. We will have to pitch our discourse, pitch our analysis at the level of what we call world system. It becomes absolutely essential to understand the working of Indian capitalism today that we should go to the working of the world capital, or to use one of my favorite phrases, it is imperative on our part to try to understand what I've been calling the cultural logic of international capital. Because if a society starts experiencing a paradigmic shift in its understanding and practices of justice, then something very deep is occurring in that society, a process which has tremendous implications for the future is happening in that particular society. So what exactly are the reasons for the shift? Did something happen in India which affected this change? So to answer this particular question, I would like to move away from the tools that we have in India to the tools that we see in the West. So theoretically, this is a different kind of exercise in the sense that it assumes there exists a world system today. There exists a certain economic phenomenon called world capitalism. There exists a certain phenomenon called international capital, which is desperately seeking to impose its inherent logic, its internal logic on other parts of the country, on other parts of the globe. So it's a different kind of intellectual method, different kind of theoretical method, where instead of offering a micro level analysis of a particular phenomenon apart, you seek to situate that in the context of a larger coherence. To analyze India, probably you have to understand the working of the international capital. In essence, this is the most decisive belief that has shaped my method. So what's happening in the West now? What's happening in the most powerful sectors of the international capital, in the most powerful geopolitical areas of international capital? Let me put it in a paradigmic fashion again. The very idea of production, the very idea of tool is undergoing a radical change even in the leading nations of international capital. Take for example the US, or take for example Japan, take Germany. If you make a list of important countries, say leading nations of international capital, the very idea of production, the very idea of, say, political economy is undergoing a radical change. To understand this, we have to arrive at a larger critique of what I call post-industrial or post-capitalist society, or post-industrial, in fact, one of my friends has used this category, post-industrial capitalism. There exists a very important traffic between leaders of the international capital in the first world and their poor counterparts in the third world. So if one understands the nature of traffic that occurs between these two spaces, then probably we will be in a better position to understand the paradigm shift that we have seen in India. In the leading geopolitical territories of international capital, as I told you, there is a desperate attempt, there is a well-defined attempt to banish everyday life and goods of everyday life from areas of production. What does it mean? They have not succeeded in doing that, they are not successful yet, but there is a calculated attempt, there is a definite attempt to change the very paradigm of production in the West, and they are trying to do that by banishing the production of everyday goods in the West. And a political philosopher calls it the decisive banishment. It may not be a factual banishment. It only means that the leading nations of international capital are buying their clothes from third world, they are buying their food grains from third world. So whatever that is important in everyday life, they are depending on the third world countries to produce these things for them. So they are dependent in the sense that they don't want to produce things that consume time, that consume energy. So the social energy that they want to invest is not in terms of everyday goods, but it's in terms of what I call goods of power and goods of authority. The shift is absolutely dramatic. Take some of the studies that are available on economies of three countries, US, Germany and Japan. And particularly in the US, it produces only power. And it's an economy which produces goods of power and authority. And now, this is slightly an abstract proposition, power is divorced from the production of everyday goods. When it all began in colonialism, the situation was different. Gandhi had to launch a nationalist struggle those days. There was no other alternative. Then he called for the boycott of foreign goods. He said, weavers in India are dying. Textile industry in India are dying and the textile communities in India are dying because we were importing goods. So in the initial stages of colonialism or in the initial stages of capitalism, colonialism combined, it was the primacy of everyday goods that destroyed, that annihilated some of the vital sectors of colonized economies. Everyday goods became so important that we had to lose our battle civilizationally. Weavers of Dhaka, weavers of West Bengal, weavers of Tamil Nadu, weavers of Karnataka were such victims produced by colonialism. But today, I'm afraid the situation is completely reversed because the West produces only power and the power rests in three sectors of production. One, high-tech sectors. There are some excellent studies available on the movement of goods in the West, particularly in the US. So the argument there is, some postmodernist scholars have done extraordinary work on this, the argument is goods no longer move in the physical sense there. It's the information on goods. So economy is organizing itself, economy of the US is trying to organize itself in a different way. So high-tech sector, so it is basically, I mean, one of the popular ways of describing this sector is to call it information sector. This no longer deals with physical goods. This deals with information on goods. And today, once again, we are caught in a situation where third world countries like India are sending human resources to the West. And US is the highest, I don't want to use the word exploiter here, he is the highest site, highest space for human resources from the third world, and particularly from Karnataka. You have to see it to believe, to understand what's happening there. New colonies of Kannadigas, new colonies of Indians who are computer scientists are being built there. So Bill Gates today is one of the most influential persons in the years. He doesn't deal with any everyday go. Has become so important in the American economy today that he can swing the foreign, that he can swing the domestic policy of the US in favor of Indians. In fact, Indians are looking up to him as God. At one level, they are trying to apply strict controls. They're trying to be nasty with other ethnic minorities. Because America as a nation, America as a nation state, is also experiencing a severe crisis. That is because multinational companies are promoting or forcing the American society to accept a kind of business policy which will go against the interests of Americans as a nation. So, this is one of the crucial sectors now, high-tech sector. It produces power. And the second sector, I don't have to discuss this in any detailed way, that is arms and ammunitions industry. The third production sector, which produces enormous wealth in the US. So, to put it in a metaphorical way, the leading economies of the West or the leading countries of the international capital have banished the production of everyday goods, or trying to banish the production of everyday goods from their economy. One or two scholars have done interesting studies in the context of the economies of newly industrialized countries. Thailand is already facing a crisis. So, West or, you know, the international capital, the leading countries of the international capital, they are treating countries like India at one level as a workshop, as a basement workshop, with which they have hardly any affinity. So they have started distrusting the production of everyday goods and everyday needs. All the dirty work now, some futurologists have already started claiming, all the dirty work for the West, for the leading capitalist nations, will be done in third world countries. So third world countries have become three kinds of spaces for the international capital now. One, a workshop; second, a dumping ground; and third, an extremely attractive leisure spot. So these things are linked in a way. They don't want to, you know, stitch clothes now. If it comes to that, they don't want to produce their meat also there. They don't want to produce their vegetables. They don't want to produce their flowers now. Because if capitalism means maximization of social energy that is available, so international capital today is trying to divert the channel of the social energy that is available for it. Its countries. So no wonder tourists from the first world countries go to Thailand. Fortunately, we are yet to open our roads for them. So their tourism means sex tourism. Their tourism means adventure tourism. Tourism is the very embodiment of all the evils represented by capitalism. So Illich, in one of his essays, says, the modern tourist is a bandit. He is just interested in looting. He loots through his senses. He loots through his money. So for him, everything is a site of pleasure. So today, no wonder that our economy is trying to develop tourism as one of the major sectors of production, of wealth generation. So what exactly is the implication of the banishment of, or the attempt to banish everyday goods from sectors of production in the first world? It creates a new kind of tension in the third world countries, because it alters the very notion of space. It alters the very notion of community, and it alters the very nature of the relationship between a human being and his or her everyday needs. The notion of everyday needs itself, that itself undergoes a radical change, and that's what is happening here. So this is the phase of centrifugal capitalism, and it's trying to create a cultural psychology of needs. It's trying to create a cultural psychology of tools where the poorest of the poor also will arrive at a new notion of justice, will arrive at a new notion of happiness. So against this background, it's perfectly understandable that for the last 10 years in our country, almost all the political classes, except one or two say movements of the poor, movements of the tribals, movements of the lower caste, more or less they have endorsed the notion of justice as aspiration based. So need based justice, the need based notion of justice is almost disappearing now. Probably it will come back, but by the time it comes back, I don't know whether we will be living together as a nation. So at this point, I would like to summarize my arguments here. That is, in India, we are defining justice as an ever-expanding opportunity in the world. So in the 50s, in the 60s, in the 70s, the justice was more or less confined, say, to the micro-level community. So in the context of Karnataka, one has to launch certain schemes. In the context of India, so the world was not there in any global sense of the word. The world was there in the sense that it was conceived as a micro-community or a cluster of communities that are linked in geo-cultural territorial sense. But now, it is seen as an ever-expanding opportunity in the world. That's one of the reasons why there existed a grand consensus about privatization, about globalization, or about the new path of development that we have accepted as a nation. So the moment you define justice as a future shareholder in a company yet to start, then naturally all the priorities will get altered. So the priorities of a nation will get altered. The priorities of local communities will get altered, whereas the cultural logic or the investment priorities of the international capital, they go unchallenged, and they will more or less succeed in imposing their will on other territories. So the most important thing is to understand the cultural will of the international capital. So what exactly is this notion of cultural will of international capital? I would focus my attention on the paradigmic shift that we are witnessing again in the life of capitalism. When it all began in the 19th century, particularly in a certain kind of Weberian understanding, it was argued that capitalism had a coherent mode of self-organization, that it has a certain objective way of organizing itself. Profit is the only motive, or profit is the only goal. If you want to earn maximum profits, then the argument was that capitalism will identify certain areas of needs, and those needs were said to be very objective. It was argued in the early theories of capitalism that capitalism had a neutral theory of needs. So on the basis of this neutrality, on the basis of these universalist theories of needs, capitalism was supposed to function. This was one of the reasons why till recently we accepted the definition of capitalism as it was said that it is driven by an objective logic of growth and development. It was said to be the example of objectivity par excellence. Capitalism was said to be the most effective, objective mode of economy that ever come to exist in the world history. But if we examine the genealogy of capitalist development now, I don't think this stands to scrutiny. Now, at least for the last 30 or 40 years or so, capitalism, particularly international capital, is no longer objective in that sense. It doesn't mean that it's not interested in profits. This is the crucial distinction that I'm trying to draw your attention to. Of course, it's interested in profits, it's interested in production, it's also interested in the acceleration of its growth. But that acceleration of growth has nothing to do with the objective understanding of the particular society that it's working with. It's interested in promoting itself. But here, my argument is, international capital is trying to impose its cultural will, it's trying to impose its modes of desire on other people as needs. So desires are being transformed as needs. This is the most important strategy, psychological strategy of the international capital. Need is no longer articulated by the John Berger, the famous art critic, has a phrase for this, is no longer the statement of the self of the addressee. So the particular address or the particular society that international capital is focusing on, its needs are no longer defined by the internal, say, opinions or internal intellectual or internal political things that are available to us. So the need of a particular society is also determined by the desire of the other. So today, precisely for this reason, we see an excessive production of certain things. We don't want them, but they have been produced here. We have a kind of ethical distrust of all these things. As a society, India ethically distrusts production of certain sectors, but they are coming into our society in a big way. So the most successful strategy of international capital is to transform everyday, the reality of everyday life into a different kind of utopia. In other words, the cultural psychological strategy of the international capital is to wipe out the line that separates everyday life and a future utopia based on market economy. So there is no difference between a future market and everyday life. This is one of the reasons why there has been a kind of consensus which covers both upper caste and lower caste in India to endorse the new economic path that we are trying to follow. This part of the story is absolutely disturbing because it raises many more important questions in the area of culture, in the area of economy, in the area of the definition of change itself. So now I would move on to the second part of the story. So before doing that, let me try to sum up the argument of my first position and then link it to the second one. So I've said, been trying to impress you with the argument that there has been a dramatic change in the very notion of justice that's being practiced by political classes in India. It's no longer need-based, it is aspiration-based. This aspiration itself is generated by the machine of the international capital. It's a psychological machine. It's a machine which has a specific cultural will, and that cultural will is no longer objective. It is decided to push through the Western notions of consumerism, Western notions of everyday life and things like that. So my next argument is, what exactly is the answer for this? So before trying to attempt to sketch one or two possible solutions or one or two possible answers, let me analyze one or two tensions that have emerged because of this cultural will of the international capital in India. And let me take one or two examples from the South Canara district itself. Two major struggles have come up in this area. One is about the rock. The second one is about the fish. Obviously, I am referring to the controversy, Pajaka controversy, and the second one is the struggle of fisherfolk struggle. So interestingly, they are interlinked. They are interlinked in the sense that we have come to accept that rocks are just granites. We have come to accept a position that oceans or seas, they are nothing but big fish tanks. So if we study the, say, psychological mechanism that has made our communities, different communities, to accept this position, then we see the presence of what I call the cultural logic or the spiritual logic of international capitalism. Ivan Illich again argues in one of his essays, he says, only for the industrialized societies, water is H2O. They are not the waters of the Vedas, they are not waters of the tribal civilization, they are not waters of the Ganga. But if a society decides to treat water as he has a word for that, a discharge of an industrial society, then waters of amnesia would have taken over the soul of the society. So today, now, interestingly, rocks have become granites. And we really assume today that rocks have no memories. And we really accept the fact, according to, you know, Western cosmologists, that oceans and seas are nothing but big water tanks. The moment you accept that rocks have no memories, then there is no other go that your sacred rock will be treated, will be used for a toilet seat somewhere in one of the industrialized societies of the West. Then whom do you blame? Let me be very frank here. The moment a traditional religious establishment accepts the promotion of a certain kind of science as one of its responsibilities, then there is no other alternative. Then naturally rocks lose their memories, rocks become granites. I am scandalized by the fact that some of the leading religious establishments of Udupi, of North India, South India, are interested in promoting science of the modern kind. I am absolutely scandalized. The moment you try to promote a new kind of, I mean the modern kind of science, the Western kind of science, then your Moola Pitha or your Moola Kshetra will have to lose its memories. They are organically linked to each other. Against this background, it's perfectly understandable that Dalits who were working in that site demanded rehabilitation. Because what exactly is the role of religion? What exactly is the role of traditional religious leaders? Because your legitimacy itself comes from the notion of a community. You are the leader of a community. You are the leader of a community which should take under its wings whole range of popular groups. The moment you deviate from your traditional understanding of religious leadership, then the dislocation cannot be stopped. The dislocation will become all pervasive. Then, to repeat my statements again, rocks will have to lose their memories. You can't blame the lower caste Dalits you can't blame them in the sense that they have raised a legitimate question of their livelihood. An ultimate solution is possible only when you revive a notion of holistic community, when you revive a notion of total community, and it becomes your moral responsibility to rehabilitate them. I'm not trying to criticize any particular religious establishment here. As a student of culture, I'm only trying to present before you patterns of dislocation. In fact, I'm convinced, absolutely convinced about my position, that traditional religious leaders have no business to go into the promotion of modern science. You will be cutting your own roots. You will be destroying yourself. Because what exactly, what about your legitimacy? It comes from a certain notion of organic community. It comes from your notion of an organic community and its relationship to society. So against this background, leading Swamijis of India of different kinds, it could be Maharshi Mahesh Yogi's Vedic Institute or it could be Adamaru Matha's Institute. There are at least 20 or 25 mutts in India, religious establishments in India trying to promote this kind of a thing. And I'm absolutely dismissive of such efforts to relocate religion in a new context. The point, the ethical responsibility of a Swamiji or of a religious establishment is to redefine the notion of community, is to redefine the notion of cultural values, Where is the need for Maharshi Mahesh Yogi to start Institute of Vedic Sciences? Can they do it better than Science and Technology Departments of India? In the first place, they don't command that kind of resources in the first place. You can't do any serious research in science if you have only 3 or 4 crores. Science and Technology is a mega establishment. You need thousands and thousands of millions of rupees. Rather, I would argue that the responsibility of a religious establishment lies in its commitment to promote, even if it is the Vedas, Upanishads. So, the irony is, religion also is trying to realign itself with a new notion of progress that has come to envelop the modern world. So religion also has come to mean aspiration-based need. Because you want to be on par with the modern world, you want to catch up with the modern world, but you don't realize the fact that the modern world does not need religious institutions of this kind. It might want it in a symbolic way, because modern capitalism or modern systems of civilization always want symbols. But symbols and substances are two different things. So now we have this sad picture. At one level, the political classes are decided to pursue a certain path of development. They have already created a kind of consensus which involves even warring classes of Indian societies. All of them are in agreement that they should be pursued with great dedication and effort. There is unprecedented kind of grit and determination on this. At another level, in any case, leaders of business and industry are committed to this new path. So, irony of ironies, that the so-called spokespersons of traditional religious establishments are also endorsing this by defining need as aspiration-based. The moment you want to re-accommodate religion in the context of a modern world on the conditions of the enemy or the rival that you are trying to encounter, at the very outset you have lost your battle. Because the notion of world community has disappeared, then the notion of responsibility disappears. At the best, you can produce only third-rate science, third-rate technology, but no one will take you if you produce third-rate science. No one will take you seriously if you produce some third-rate science with sprinkles, with one or two drops of religion, with one or two drops of spirituality. See, religion also has become a party, has become a vehicle of a new kind of progress and development that we are seeking in India. So religion also has to bear the responsibility of this crime. It's also one of the parties of this wicked game perpetrated by a conglomeration of several classes in India. Friends, I will finish my talk with a discussion on a letter. The letter is written by Mahatma Gandhi. He wrote that to one of his friends. And the first line of the letter is, Harilal's glass is always red. Harilal, as you know, was one of the deviant sons of Mahatma Gandhi. He was a drunkard. He was the very embodiment of sin. So Gandhi acknowledges this fact. And he begins a letter with this statement. Harilal's glass is always red. It's red because there is alcohol in it. It is red because there is liquor in it. And then Gandhi starts to reflect on the possible causes of the degeneration of the sun. What happened to the sun? Why did it degenerate in this way? And then Gandhi proceeds. He offers a kind of spiritual psychology, a kind of, homespun spiritual psychology of the Gandhian kind. So he says that Harilal was conceived by Gandhi. In those days, where Gandhi was, ashamedly lusty, unashamedly lusty, he was interested in sex. He was not interested in santana srishti, but he was interested in gratification of senses. The next sentence he says, so because of that moment of conception, now I am paying for it. Now I am being punished for the thing that I committed then. He doesn't blame anyone, he doesn't blame the milieu. And then he ends this letter, I have to face it. So look at the mechanism of transition there. It begins with the analysis of the body. It begins with the analysis of the self. And then he says, Harilal is not really separate from his father. And the society which has produced both Harilal and Gandhi, that is also, that cannot be separate from the father and the son. So the movement is very complex, but identifiable. It's identifiable in the sense that from Harilal's glass, it goes on to analyze Gandhi, the father, and then the son, and then the society, and again it comes back to the self. So my argument is, unless we have a new notion of body, unless we have a new notion of the limits to desire, I don't think we'll be ever able to produce a new notion of progress, a new notion of development. The new notion of the contemporary notion of progress we have has based itself on limitless desire, limitless gratification of desires. So Pampa, the 10th century Kannada poet, organically connects two things in a beautiful way. He says, Kidu vadala, kidu varajyada, the body which rots and the state which also rots. So the way the shamanic imagination, the way the Jaina imagination connects two unconnectable things is remarkable. If the body rots, then the polity also rots. If the body decays, there is no other alternative, there is no other go. The polity, the society, the state also rots. Then in a culture, in an atmosphere, where you accept the limitless desire as the real need, or in a cultural atmosphere, in a psychological atmosphere, where you accept aspiration-based need as the real need, then there is no emancipation to this particular kind of society. But a last question remains, a very crucial question remains. Can you say this to lower caste? Can you say this to the poor with a great deal of confidence? I'm afraid not. For the simple reason, it has to be, one has to recreate a notion of a total community. Total community in the sense that if only elites of this country accept this proposition, then automatically you can ask the lower caste also to follow the suit. But if you ask only the poor, if you ask only the lower caste to do that, they have got every right to reject the demand. Then the leader and the slave probably will be sailing in the same boat. There lies the common tragedy for both of them. Thank you.